The following program is brought to you by Total Theater Online. The views expressed do not necessarily represent those of the staff or management of WGBB. You're listening to the station that serves your community, 1240 WGBB. And now it's time for Dave's Gone By with David Lefkowitz.
Tropical hot dog night. I see flamingos in a fruit fight. Every color of day. Whirling around at night. I'm playing this music. So the young girl will come out to be the monster tonight. Tropical hot dog night.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Dave's Gone By. Talk radio, comedy, music, interviews, outer views, and more. Coming to live from the heart of the nautical Merrick. Tell your family, tell your friends, bring your grandparents. Crowd around the radio so close that my body odor permeates your living room. Because then you'll have to throw open the windows and let the primetime sunshine in. Kind of missed the beginning of spring 2 weeks ago because of all the current events going on. It was hard to concentrate on celestial bodies when you have human bodies being smashed to bits so gloriously. Also, we had 1 week of great weather, and then it suddenly turned winter again. Last Sunday at the station, I was not only doing my show, but co-hosting the Sunday edition of Midnight Madness, hosted by Mike Artsis. And that show ran, aptly enough, until midnight. And by the way, it will be back again tonight from 11 to midnight. Mike Artsis is out of town, but keep listening because I'll be on there with Engineer Paul, and I think Engineer Joe is going to call in. It'll be a lot of fun. But anyway, last week, I'm doing the show with Mike and a couple of other people. I look out the door as I'm getting ready to catch the train, and there's flurries. It's 35 degrees. It had been raining and snaining all day. And suddenly, it's like we're thrust back into the middle of February, which I think tomorrow is going to be as well. And we all remember what winter was like, and I just felt like it was one more cosmic joke God was playing on us this year. He gives us the most punishing, unpleasant season in 10 years. He gives us the worst president we've had in 30 years. He gives us an overseas war that has the whole country screaming at each other. He takes our minds off anthrax by giving us SARS. And then, just to ream us all out one more time, God goes, I think I'll bring back winter just as soon as they've all put their heavy coats away. I'll zap them with a high-pressure system. Oh, and I think I'll raise subway fares, too. So the week started off really nippy and rainy, but then we felt the thaw again. Little baby springlet chased away old man winter, hopefully for good, and just in time for the clock changing. Hope you remember to spring ahead at 2 o'clock this past morning. I don't know where that hour goes. All I know is any reason to keep daylight going till 8 in the evening is causing up for celebration. And that's exactly what we're doing on this edition of Dave's Gone By. We're celebrating the true arrival of spring. We're standing eggs on their heads. We're eating raw sugar carved seductively to look like little birdies. We're stocking up on matzo meal and alcohol-fortified grape juice. We're driving to the Hamptons. We're cycling to Jones Beach. We're marching to Basra. We're waiting for our dread of hay fever to overtake our fear of pneumonia. We're filling the swimming pools. We're grilling the hamburgers. We're killing the enemy. And more than anything else, we're basking in the sunshine with a bag of goodies for our feathered friends. When you attend 23? Well, we just had a bit of a CD miscue on there. So instead we're going to try re-cueing that. It should have been a springtime song, not a deadly war song. Might as well play the deadly war song instead. Or something. Oh, I have to keep chattering here. But that was the piano of Tom Lehrer. Didn't quite hear the voice yet, although either we're going to hear the voice on that song or the song that I had intended, which is, what springtime song comes to your mind when you think of Tom Lehrer? That one.
Spring is here, a suffering is here. Life is Skittles and life is beer. I think the loveliest time of the year is the spring. I do, don't you? Of course you do. But there's one thing that makes spring complete for me, and makes every Sunday a treat for me. All the world seems in tune on a spring afternoon when we're poisoning pigeons in the park. Every Sunday you'll see my sweetheart and me as we poison the pigeons in the park. When they see us coming, the birdies all try and hide, but they still go for peanuts when coated with cyanide. The sun's shining bright, everything seems all right when we're poisoning pigeons in the park. We've gained notoriety and caused much anxiety in the Audubon Society with our games. They call it impiety and lack of propriety and quite a variety of unpleasant names. But it's not against any religion to want to dispose of a pigeon. So if Sunday you're free, why don't you come with me and we'll poison the pigeons in the park. And maybe we'll do in a squirrel or two while we're poisoning pigeons in the park. We'll murder them all amid laughter and merriment, except for the few we take home to experiment. My pulse will be quickening with each drop of strychnine we feed to a pigeon. It just takes a pigeon to poison a pigeon in the park.
So early, early in the spring, I shipped on board to serve my king. I left my dear, she takes me by the hand. If ever I marry, you'll be the man. A thousand vows so long and sweet, saying we'll be married when next we meet. And all the time I sail the sea, could not find from her.
Hey, Vern. Vern, it's me, Equinox. I hope you've been saving your daylight time. Wouldn't run out of it in the middle of the day. There you are in the middle of a softball game at noon and suddenly it's pitch black. Know what I mean? Know what I mean? Oh boy, that is the height of radio desperation, ladies and gentlemen, impersonating Jim Varney. I promise it will get better in earnest, but you gotta keep listening. It's our 27th show. And if you tuned in at 7:30, please know that we're back to our old time, 8 to 9 p.m. Sunday nights. For a while, we tacked on an extra half hour, starting at 7:30, but the station changed its whole weekend schedule around, and for the sake of continuity, we're back up to the primetime 8 o'clock slot, still offering DGB-13 content in an NC-17 world. Same show, music, comedy, hazy ramblings and crazy scramblings, and the same Dave. Dave Lefkowitz, radio personality, humorist, journalist, songwriter, and voice of the uptrodden. And I'm here every Sunday night on WGBB AM 1240 and also streaming live on the internet. And if you live three towns away, but your radio sounds like it's been smuggled into Peter Arnett's colon, don't fret. Just turn on your computer, go to WGBB.com and click the button for online radio. We have listeners all over the free world. Well, whatever few parts of the world are actually free, but you know what I'm saying. Come celebrate spring with Dave's Gone By tonight. We heard Tom Lehrer and Judy Collins before. By the way, the Tom Lehrer was my miscue. It should have been track 24. I said 23. Whoops. And we have more music coming up, including Simon and Garfunkel and some Vernal Equinoxes. Plus, the news gone by, of course, a World Weird Web segment. Haven't done that in a while. And more. So stick around as we toss out the first pitch, the news gone by, right after this. Are you a member of the Rotary Club, the Hadassah, the Elks? Big deal. Why not join something really cool for a change? The Bystanders Club, the official Dave's Gone By fan club. Bystanders get a weekly special email, a bi-monthly newsletter devoted to the show, an autographed membership card eligible for discounts on show merchandise and local businesses, and a one-hour best-of audio tape with gems from the show and maybe even stuff we couldn't put on the radio. It's still just $10 to join. For the newsletter, the email, the best-of audio tape, for the cost of 2 porno magazines, and not even good ones, you can show your support for Dave's Gone By. Just make a $10 check or money order payable to Total Theater and send it to Total Theater, Box 62, that's 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. You can also join via PayPal. The email address, davesgoneby@aol.com, davesgoneby@aol.com. Oh, if you're a man who can't get a date, if you're a girl who can't find a mate, if you stay home and master yourself, it's time for a nice dating. Friday nights at 6 p.m. is the Bonnie Lassie, Bonnie D. Graham, hosting a show for singles looking to meet, greet, and get pissing drunk. For talk about sex and relationships, tune in Fridays at 6 for Long Island's Dating on WJBB. If you want to meet a boy or girl, then give your radio dial a twirl, drink a pint, get ready to hurl, it's time for a nice dating. It's time for a nice dating. Welcome back to Dave's Gone By. It's time for the news gone by. 8:14 p.m. A look at events of the past week from a this would have been 7:14 p.m. last week perspective. Of course, we begin with war news. In operation, let's call it Iraqi freedom because calling it Operation Control the Middle East doesn't sound as noble. A senior official with the U.S. military told reporters that the government is willing to pay, quote, a very high price to win this war. We are going to ensure, he said, that this regime goes away. And if that means there will be a lot of casualties, then there will be a lot of casualties, unquote. Funny how they forgot to mention this a couple of months ago when we were giving Saddam Hussein a timetable to disarm. Strange how for all his speeches and press conferences, Donald Rumsfeld never took 30 seconds to say, despite our massive quantities of ballistic weapons, there's going to be weeks of ground fighting and we're willing to sacrifice hundreds, make it thousands, of American men to set a bunch of Arabs free. Amazing that when he was asking Tony Blair to jump on board, President Bush didn't whisper, we're making lots of caskets and flags, just in case. I don't mean to be an alarmist, but there's plenty of red, white, and blue cloth left over for you guys. Well, from speaking too little, we move to a guy who talked too much, TV journalist Peter Arnett. He gave an interview to Iraqi television last weekend in which he said America's early war strategy had failed. That's a quote. Failed because we underestimated the determination of Iraqi soldiers. Whether true or not, Arnett was fired from both NBC and National Geographic, presumably for giving aid and comfort to the enemy. Now, in a related story, filmmaker Michael Moore, who made anti-war remarks at the Oscars, was nearly banned from the Motion Picture Academy of Arts and Sciences. Moore's speeches proclaim that Americans are lazy, overweight, violent, ignorant about the government, apathetic about current events, and obsessed with sex, glamour, and trivia. The MPAA rescinded its ban on Moore when it realized his words were, in fact, giving aid and comfort to Hollywood. Although the United Nations has chosen to spectate instead of participate in the war, that hasn't stopped them from armchair quarterbacking. Now that the U.S. has all but toppled the Hussein regime and seems just days away from controlling the capital, the nations of NATO and the European Union are demanding a role in running post-war Iraq. Of course, comrades-in-arms America and England will have first dibs on every grain of sand in that Allah-forsaken country, with Australia, Poland, and other members of the coalition also likely to get the best gigs. But Secretary of State Colin Powell did not rule out help from the anti-war members of the UN. After all, Powell said, nobody shines shoes like a German, scrapes off grills like a Belgian, or cleans toilets like a Frenchman. Now, the children's wing of the United Nations, UNICEF, also complained this week. They're saying packets of food being handed out by troops as humanitarian aid are the same size and bright yellow color as small bombs being dropped in the same places. The concern, of course, is that children wouldn't mistake unexploded bomb packets for dinner. UNICEF is pleading with the U.S. military to modify the color of its explosive packs, or at the very least, change the label to read Taco Bell so that children would know what to expect. Speaking of knowing what to expect, last week we did a sketch about an army grunt, an 18-year-old private taken as a prisoner of war. And one point of the sketch was just how young these kids are who are volunteering to be in the armed forces. It was about how vacuous and directionless these teenagers are, not all of them, but in so many, they see the military as a slightly harsher version of the Peace Corps. Go do your time marching around, get yelled at, learn all these skills, and then come home with money for a college education. Meanwhile, the fine print, the oh by the way clause, is that you can be used as cannon fodder for any military action the government sees fit to point you at. So, go figure. A week after the sketch, the Associated Press carries a story about a 20-year-old Marine reservist who didn't show up for active duty and later surrendered to military police. Declaring himself a conscientious objector, Stephen Funk told AP, quote, ultimately it was my fault for joining in the first place. It wasn't as well thought as out as it should have been. It was about me being depressed and wanting direction in life. Asked why he enlisted, Funk blamed a recruiter for capitalizing on his vulnerability. During basic training, Funk felt uncomfortable doing the exercise where you're supposed to scream kill, kill, kill while committing acts of mock violence. Funk said, and this is beautiful, he said, quote, they don't really advertise that they kill people. I didn't realize the full implications of what I was doing. I don't really realize they kill people. In his defense, Funk was also shocked to learn that the restaurants he would pass on the street when he was growing up served food, and that the vast majority of residents in nursing homes are, in fact, old. In They Hate Us, They Really Hate Us news, Mayor Bloomberg has condemned certain textbooks used by private Muslim schools in the city. The books are said to contain overtly anti-Semitic passages. For example, the best-selling What is Islam All About charges that many Jews and Christians lead, quote, decadent and immoral lives. Well, sure, it's true, but other books also criticize the Jews specifically for, quote, killing their own prophet and subscribing to racial superiority. Now, the Board of Ed is in a sticky place because they can't regulate the religious curriculum of private schools. They are, however, trying to convince Muslim teachers to use different books, such as Harry Potter and the Evil Palace of Uday, Horton Hears a Scud and Neutralizes It, and the children's book Where's Waldo Muhammad, in which readers scan the wreckage of Baghdad to find the bones of a rock-throwing teenager. In health news, the Bush administration's revisions of the Clean Air Act have come under fire from environmentalists. The Republican plan allows thousands of coal-burning factories and refineries to continue business as usual with only routine maintenance. That's instead of replacing equipment with expensive new parts that greatly reduce pollution. Opponents are saying that to allow old facilities to go unchanged will mean years of smog and acid rain. Industry spokesmen say they've already cut down air pollution by making voluntary upgrades and by asking John Ashcroft not to talk. Here's some earth-shaking news. Scientists have been studying and mapping out a major geological fault line running beneath downtown Los Angeles. According to the Associated Press, over the past 11,000 years, that area has received at least 4 earthquakes, measuring more than 7 on the Richter scale. That's bad news for L.A., because most of the buildings there are able to withstand a quake of 5, but not 7. The good news, scientists say, is that history has shown a giant earthquake only happens on that fault once every 2,000 years. And it's true. I grabbed a book out of the library. It's by Tiberius, the second emperor of Rome. And he writes, Dear Diary, just got word that the natives across the Atlantic had a cataclysm last week, debris everywhere, and sending emissaries to offer aid and support. Their medicine men tell us the good news is that such an event occurs only every 2,000 years. Otherwise, all quiet in Rome, hard to believe it's been only 3 years since we killed that Jesus fellow. Mustache, Tiberius. In entertainment news, Chinese pop singer and actor Leslie Cheung committed suicide on Tuesday, jumping from the balcony of a 5-star hotel in Hong Kong. The flamboyant and openly gay performer was best known for playing a homosexual opera singer who, ironically enough, commits suicide in the film Farewell My Concubine. Asked why the character and then the real-life actor both committed suicide, a spokesperson for Cheung said, "Have you ever heard Chinese opera?" In music news, well, it's the domino effect. First, the Rolling Stones were asked not to play certain songs on their concert tour of China for fear tunes like Brown Sugar would be too raunchy for the Mellow Yellow. Now, Paul McCartney, on his first European tour in a decade, has agreed to tone the decibels down when he gets to Rome. He was told that the Colosseum was near enough to the Vatican that a loud rock concert might keep the Pope awake all night. A spokesman for McCartney says the former Beatle might excise Live and Let Die and Back in the USSR because of volume. However, he will be doing the old 1950s standard Shake, Rattle, and Roll, since that's exactly how the Pope spends most of his afternoons. Speaking of Muslims from parts unknown, New York taxi drivers will have an easier time getting their licenses now, thanks to a newly revised program from the TLC. Instead of the previous 80-hour course new drivers had to endure, cabbies now just have to take a 3-day, 24-hour blitz program, and they're on the road. Of course, with a shorter curriculum, the final exam had to be made a little less demanding. For example, one question asks, you pick up a fare at Lincoln Center, and they want to be taken to Grand Central Station. At what point do you stop at an Indian restaurant and ask directions? Is it A, Union, New Jersey, B, Morristown, New Jersey, C, the coast of Maine, or D, don't stop at a restaurant, a white policeman is bound to hassle you on the way, so you might as well just ask him? And the answer, of course, is D, ask the cop, unless your passengers are tourists, in which case you drive 3 times around 65th Street, charge them $30, and drop them off in the middle of Central Park. And what would the news gone by be without a story from the syndicated Weird But True column published locally in the New York Post? This week, police are hunting a flasher who runs around the University of Alabama exposing himself to co-eds. The pervert, naked from the waist down and wearing a striped polo shirt, disguises his face as Groucho Marx, including the trademark glasses, big rubber nose, and mustache. I don't know about the cigar, but anyway, he streaks across the campus, finds his victim, does a little dance, and then runs away. Rumor has it that on these missions, he also sings a revised version of a classic Marx Brothers tune, Hello, I Must Be Coming. Sad news from Florida. 3 tour buses carrying Maryland High School band students to a music festival in Orlando crashed into each other. The first bus had stopped for traffic, the second rear-ended it, and the third plowed into the other 2. 59 children were wounded, 2 critically. The good news is that both of them have discovered a brand new way to play the oboe. In Broadway news, I'm sorry about that one. There was no miracle on 42nd Street this month. A revival of William Gibson's classic drama, The Miracle Worker, about Helen Keller and her teacher Anne Sullivan, was supposed to open at the Music Box Theater in 2 weeks, but things fell apart in rehearsals, and the producers pulled the plug on the show. Hilary Swank, who starred as Anne, took the cancellation in stride, saying she was sorry New Yorkers couldn't see Anne Sullivan, but then again, neither could Helen. I'm terrible tonight. And asked if she was disappointed in the closing, the young girl playing Helen said, "Ugh!" Oh, yes, they're just getting worse and worse. Some happy celebrity news. Sharon Osbourne has been declared cancer-free. After months of treatment and chemo, the soon-to-be talk show host and wife of rocker Ozzy Osbourne has been given a clean bill of health. In fact, her chief doctor told the press only a week ago Sharon Osbourne had a disgusting, malignant, and unidentified foreign body inside her, but making love to Ozzy is her choice. A new scientific study has learned, I'm just looking at the engineer here, we're having fun, a new scientific study has learned that human sperm have built-in smell receptors. The little critters apparently show greater motility and homing instincts when they encounter sweet or floral odors. Commenting on the discovery, one scientist told the New York Post, "For the sake of overpopulation, it's a good thing they don't like the smell of tuna fish." German sculptor Bernd Eyls, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, hopes to expand his repertoire now that he's found his material of choice, cow dung. 10 years ago, Eyls was walking through a field and noticed the consistency of sheep dip was similar to that of the paints he was using. The artist told Reuters, "I used sheep droppings at first, but they were too small, so I switched to cow dung." Now, Eyls points out that cows fed on carrots and turnips produce red-colored feces, which is visually attractive, but not as durable as the poo from cows fed on grass. For the past decade, Eyls has made wall clocks and small statues out of bovine excrement. But now he wants to work smaller scale, so he's designing alarm clocks and wristwatches. Now, his work has made many top 10 lists throughout Europe, assumedly from art collectors who appreciate one-plop shopping. Eyls has also been voted least likely to find an apprentice, a girlfriend, or a loft. His creations have also led to some odd exchanges from people visiting his gallery, such as, "Excuse me, do you have the time?" "Oh, yes, it's 1:30. Ugh!" And that's the news gone by for April 6, 2003. Please send your comments, opinions, and fecal matters to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062, or email us at davesgoneby@aol.com. We reserve the right to read your letters on the air, name withheld upon request, rank and serial number freely given. That's Dave's Gone By, no apostrophe, @aol.com, or snail mail, Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. Please, no Groucho masks, unless you can prove that's really a cigar. If you're a good American, that means you like to own things. Well, now's your chance. You can own a piece of my show. That's right, Dave's Gone By is ready to promote you. If you have a product, event, or service to hawk shamelessly, you can buy 30 or 60 seconds of advertising time on my show. You can even be a sponsor. Just imagine. This week's News Gone By is brought to you by you. We'll be right back after this word from your product. Advertising on Dave's Gone By is cost-effective and reaches listeners not only on Long Island, but thanks to WGBB.com all over the world. To get a piece of the Dave, call 516-295-1511 or email davesgoneby@aol.com. To see our disgustingly low ad rates, check our website, hometown.aol.com/davesgoneby. Remember, you could be talking to you right now. Are you listening? Every Saturday night at 7:30, right here on WGBB, it's Joe Salzone Live. Tell us about it, Joe.
Well, Dave, it's a half-hour, fast-paced glimpse at the world we live in.
Joe Salzone brings his old-fashioned, conservative views, along with his desire to hear all viewpoints, to the airwaves each week. It's a one-of-a-kind show that you'll hear only on Long Island's news and information leader,
1240 AM WGBB,
the station that serves your community.
Tra-la-bri promise of merry sunshine. As we merrily dance and we sing, tra-la, we welcome the hope that they bring, tra-la, of a summer of roses and wine, of a summer of roses and wine. And that's what we mean when we say that a thing is welcome as flowers that bloom in the spring. Tra-la-la-la-la, tra-la-la-la-la, the flowers that bloom in the spring. The flowers that bloom in the spring, ta-la, have nothing to do with the case. I've got to take under my wing, ta-la, a most unattractive old thing, ta-la, with a caricature of a face. With the caricature of a face. And that's what I mean when I say or I sing. Oh, bother the flowers that bloom in the spring. Tra-la-la-la-la, tra-la-la-la-la. Oh, bother the flowers of spring.
Tra-la-la-la-la, tra-la-la-la-la.
Welcome back to Dave's Gone By. Time for a segment we haven't done in a while, the World Weird Web. That's where we look at odd or unusual or fun or helpful websites on the internet and share their content with you all. Tonight, Spring Springs Eternal, in honor of our clock-turning ritual, so we bring you a site that's all dewy and verdant, poetic and prayer-filled. It's called Spiritual Springtime, and it's at www.spiritualspringtime.org. Actually, when you type that URL, it redirects you to a different one, origin.org, but they're the same thing, www.spiritualspringtime.org. And it's very simple and direct, a little New Agey. And if you click on the tree, it brings you to something called a database of dreams, supposedly corresponding to leaves on the tree. They're not dreams, actually. They're very short prayers and hopes submitted by people to the website. I guess it's kind of like the stuff people scribble down and stick in the stones when they're at the Wailing Wall. And the homepage reads, "You are about to enter a virtual sacred site. Please take a moment to become quiet within yourself before entering." No jokes. They really mean well. Spiritual Springtime, they say, is a living, growing, cyber object of art, which you are invited to co-create. So people submit their mini affirmations, prayers for the sick, hopes for peace, posted well before the war. And each dream, more than 700 of them, each is supposed to be a leaf on the giant spiritual tree, which is cool. So you get submissions like Baby L. "May our baby be born healthy and safe and grow to become wise and kind." That's it. Very sweet. I'm not being ironic here. The site is just plain nice, in a Mr. Rogers kind of way. Here's Ian's prayer. "I pray that in the new millennium, the world will be more beautiful, and people will be more nice. I pray that the forests and nature will be so beautiful, people will not be able to resist them." Ian is age 7, by the way. And I'm sure the submissions to the website are vetted pretty carefully, because even the ones that look like they're going to be cranks turn out to be straight, such as "Gettin' Jiggy With It," submitted from a writer whose email name is Pigpen7. But "Gettin' Jiggy With It" reads, "May your purpose find you, my friend, then may you have the wisdom to find it." It's one of the gracious things about the site. Almost none of the posts are truly laughable or crude. And it's kind of an antidote if you've ever read a news story on America Online and then gone to read what people are posting on the AOL bulletin board about it. Because you get heartfelt stuff or politically strong convictions, and then someone answers back, and then every third or fourth post is so bizarrely offensive as to make you wonder just who's out there. And then there are three or four more posts of people flaming at the guy who's an idiot or anti-Semitic or anti-gay, and then he writes obscenities back, of course. And soon, no matter what the topic, three-quarters of the dialogue is people calling each other a-holes and screaming "drop dead" in capital letters. And that's amusing for a while, but the charm wears off after the 10th guy says, "All foreigners should shut up and leave America," and the 11th guy says, "Why don't you go play with yourself, retard?" And the great American tradition of political debate goes on from there. But not at spiritualspringtime.org. Granted, you do get spelling errors like you wouldn't believe, such as "seed of love" spelled S-E-A-D, or as one paragraph prayer misspells the word "humanity," "experience," "realm," "release," "criticism," and "most." And sometimes the prayers veer from being truly universal to something a tad more self-involved, such as this one from Marvin, titled "Cosmogonist." "I dream of living where people grow their own food and practice meditation of light and sound. I wish I could find musicians to play in a band with. I wish I could play my songs about light and life to the world and eat fresh organic fruits and vegetables. And that is my dream in this life. And would it be too much to dream of sensual love with a beautiful woman before I die?" Yes, Marvin, it would. But the vegetables is a reasonable goal. And here's an affirmation without punctuation called "United States Educational Department." "It is my prayer that all governmental functions like the Educational Department see the error of their ways in trying to force the people to pay back the student loans that they give out. It should not be made to be paid back. Education should be free. And all collection agencies stop their harassing of individuals at their homes and should not be allowed to be oh so powerful. This is my prayer. Hey, look, everybody has his own axe to grind and his own belief system. Another section of the website moves from the leaves of the tree to the roots, meaning religions. Nothing freaky or cult-like, just a hyperlinked listing of websites for various churches and theologies. Everything from the Roman Catholic Church Vatican to the Alliance for Jewish Renewal, the Mile High Church of Religious Science, the Third Apex to Fractopia, not even a religious thing, just a gallery of fractal art, and the Wisteria Center for Well-Being. Anyway, the website, which is run by Now and Zen Inc., they make things like Zen alarm clocks and tea sets. The website invites everyone to add your own prayers and spiritual homepages. So give spiritualspringtime.org a look if you want to make fun, or if you want to take it seriously, or a bit of both. God knows, I'm as far from a mystical crystal type as you can get. But what can I really say against a person, even if they call themselves Om Shanti Om, when they write, "In my heart, the stillness of all eternity reaches out to caress and heal this universe through divine peace and love," unquote. Through birth and death, renewal and destruction, the only thing that has never died on this planet is hope, reason enough to keep seeking the spiritual in springtime.
When streams are ripe and swelled with rain, may she will stay, resting in my arms again. June, she'll change her tune. In restless walk she'll prowl the night. July she will fly and give no warning to her flight. August dies she must. The autumn low, chilly and cold. September I'll remember. A love once knew has now grown old.
Broadway, off-Broadway, cabaret. These are magical words conjuring up a universe of great entertainment. If you want to know everything about what's happening on the stages of New York, you need to get Performing Arts Insider magazine. For 60 years, Performing Arts Insider has been a bible of the industry. It tells you when shows are opening and closing, what they're about, who's in it, designers, writers, composers, contacts for producers and managers, box office info, parental guides, everything you need to know if you care about theater, opera, and dance too. As the chief editor of Backstage put it, Performing Arts Insider is who, what, where, and when, all the facts at your fingertips. For more information, how to subscribe or get a sample issue, call 516-295-1511 or go to www.totaltheater.com and click on Performing Arts Insider. Sunday nights at 7, it's a new spin on old-fashioned radio when Don Lewis hosts Entertainment Long Island. It's an hour of interviews and advice about how to get started as a performer, be it as a career or a hobby. Every show has nostalgia, humor, and live music by Eddie Hug and the boys, so catch the corny jokes and talented folks on Entertainment Long Island right before Dave's Gone By. It all starts Sunday night at 7 on WGBB because the stage is a world of entertainment. Welcome back to Dave's Gone By, and time for Dave's Gone Cultural. A lot of times we do theater reviews in this segment or talk to theater people. Today we're doing mostly a movie thing, or to be more technical, a DVD thing. The release, and I'm sure it was a year or two ago, but I finally caught up with it, of The Producers on DVD from MGM Video. And it is, of course, the funniest, the greatest comedy ever made. Second by second, the funniest of all, even more than Duck Soup or Monty Python and the Holy Grail, which is certainly saying something. It is my father's favorite movie of all time. It's pretty close to mine. And it has that special thing for Jewish men. There's just something that we see in it, and it's also, for me, about the theater and about just people who are desperate to do something that they desperately love, and they do it in such a bizarre and sick and wonderful way that you can't help but watch and fall in love with every minute of this picture. It was, of course, directed by Mel Brooks, his first film, in 1968, with Zero Mostel and Gene Wilder and a host of wonderful supporting characters. The story, as we all know, since it was such a huge cause célèbre thanks to the musical Broadway version done 2 years ago and still running about 90% box office capacity, is just this down-on-his-luck producer who used to be the biggest hit on Broadway, Max Bialystock, 6 shows running at once, and then flop after flop, and he's keeping off the tax creditors, and the only way he's managing to stay afloat is to bilk all these old women out of checks by giving them a little bit of a, shall we say, sexual thrill. And he's walked in on by this mousy little accountant in the film played by Gene Wilder on Broadway by Matthew Broderick. And the accountant, just by doing the books, discovers that, and you can't really do this for real, but in the context of the film, what you can do is jigger the numbers in such a way that you spend all this money to put the show on. And if it's a big hit, then you've got to pay back all the backers. And if you don't have that money, then you go to jail because it's fraud. But nobody's going to investigate a flop. So you raise thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. You have a one-night flop. Then you take your money and go, and nobody cares. So they try to pick the absolute worst musical with all the worst crew and the worst actors that they possibly can. And what better than Springtime for Hitler by an old, unregenerate Nazi. And they pick a flaming, gay, ridiculous director to camp it up completely. And they figure they can't win, so they can't lose. They're going to have a terrible, horrible thing. All the critics are going to slam it. All the audiences are going to walk out. And they're going to fly off to Rio. Except, of course, it doesn't work out that way. And I won't give out any more. But sure, I don't need to be talking about a movie that's, 35 years old at this point, but the fact that it is on DVD, I wanted to talk about this particular release. Because not only do you get a pristine version of the film in proper format, but on the other side of the disc, and that's one thing that I wanted to mention is really cool. A lot of times when they release these DVDs, they're these bulky things, and you have one disc with a movie on it, and then another disc with all the cool extras. In this case, and I don't know why they don't always do this, or why they can't even do this with regular CDs of music, you have on one side the movie, you flip the disc over, same disc, and that's where all the documentary stuff and the special cool extras are. I think it's pretty neat and probably saves a lot of, I don't know, I don't think you cut down trees to make CDs, but you cut down little plastic bushes and you save some of those. Anyway, how is the documentary? It's actually a really nice, lengthy, 90-minute piece with so many of the people involved in the film interviewed, including Kenneth Mars, who played Franz, the crazy Kraut, and Andreas Voutsinas, who was Carmen Gia, the assistant. And now he doesn't even look like that with the weird tan and that great beard. Now he's just even more bizarre, just completely bald, like a tiny bald version of the actor or actress Divine, crossed with Iranian director Assurbanipal Babila. I mean, I doubt anybody knows what that guy looks like, but you can sort of imagine. And aside from everything else, the documentary is divided into a couple of different parts. The beginning of how Brooks put the film together, it was originally going to be a play. And then people read it and there were too many different... it was originally going to be a story or a novel. And there was just too much dialogue in it. And he realized, this should be a play. Until people said, no, there's too many locations, too much going on, it's got to be a movie. And finally Brooks adapted it into that. And you learn all sorts of stuff from Brooks on the documentary, from the other people that they interview, including Gene Wilder, including Lee Meredith, who, of course, played Ula, the receptionist. And one of the great things about the extras is they have an intermission, which is just Ula dancing, as we all remember from the film. Now, Lee Meredith, you figure that movie was made in 1968. Even if she was in her early 20s, she's you know, got to be close to 50s, 60s now. And I swear, she still looks, as Max Bialystock would say, a wah-wah-wah-wah-wah-wah. I mean, some actresses get older and you still say, oh, you know, she looks really good. Meaning, for her age, she looks terrific. But this woman, I mean, there's got to be a painting in her closet that looks like Helen Thomas, because she still has everything, and she does the Ula dance. But enough of that. The other part of all the documentary is stories by Mel Brooks and everybody telling things that you might not have known about the whole production. Did you know that the famous Lincoln Center fountain scene was a last-minute replacement? Originally, Max was going to talk Leo into going through with this whole scheme, and Leo was going to say yes when they were skydiving. Will you do it, Leo? Yes, I'll do it! And they plunge out of an airplane. But the coordination of that became so expensive and so difficult, they had to think of something else. So instead, they did it around the fountain at Lincoln Center, which is, of course, this incredibly beautiful, wonderful sequence, and the very last one they shot for the film. And it was done on the last day of filming, and then everybody went out for breakfast. And also, did you know that Leo's famous poignant speech, where he defends, kind of, Max in the courtroom, was Gene Wilder's idea and mostly his words. Initially, Leo just basically sits in the courtroom and Max does his spiel. But Gene said, look, I've been an important part of this whole story the whole time, and yet I say nothing at the end of the film. Let me come up with something, see if you like it. Mel Brooks looked at it, made a few changes, and that's the speech, the great speech that went into the film. And then the documentary goes on, and you see the opening of the movie was even worse than the one that the production number and then the show has in the film. At the initial screening, I forget where it was, there was almost nobody in the audience. And the one person who did laugh was a bag lady. She laughed once during the Springtime for Hitler number and then went back to sleep. But other extras on the DVD include still photos and a couple of outtakes. That's really going to be for the real people who love the movie, including the famous lost, so-called, sequence where when they go to blow up the theater, we all know what happens is they do the thing where instead of the correct fuse, they use the quick fuse so they don't get out of the building in time. But initially, what had been written and filmed was William Hickey, who plays the drunk in the bar, failure, actually, wanders into the cave, accidentally sees a shoeshine stand, and puts his foot on it, only it's not a shoeshine stand, it's a TNT box, and he puts his foot and boom. But they said that just slowed down the action a little too much, and instead they went with the quick fuse. Anyway, I could go on and on with all these wonderful extras, but I'm telling you, it's the producers on DVD, MGM Home Entertainment, lots of stuff about Zero, lots of stuff about Gene Wilder and Mel Brooks, and everybody, highly recommended, and ever so appropriate for this time of year.
Springtime for Hitler and Germany. Come and join the Nazi party.
Well, hasn't felt like spring the past few days, or certainly tomorrow it won't, but the clock says it is, the calendar says it is, and Frank Sinatra will say it is, because we're going to be playing a little bit of him to end the show. We'll be playing Rodgers and Hammerstein, not from one of their Broadway shows, but from State Fair, which is their only film score, and they didn't do too badly. It's called It Might As Well Be Spring, and it won the 1945 Oscar for Best Song. And we celebrate spring with Frank and the boys. What better, Frank Sinatra and Hitler back to back? Just figured that might make a nice segue there.
I'm as restless as a willow in a windstorm. I'm as jumpy as a puppet on a string. I'd say that I had spring fever, but I know it isn't spring. I am starry-eyed and vaguely discontented, like a nightingale without a song to sing. Oh, why should I have spring fever when it isn't even spring? I keep wishing I was somewhere else, walking down a strange new street, hearing words that I have never heard from a girl I've yet to meet. I'm as busy as a spider spinning daydreams. I'm as giddy as a baby on a swing. I haven't seen a crocus or a rosebud or a robin on the wing, but I feel so gay in a melancholy way that it might as well be spring.
Well, maybe this week it'll finally start to feel like springtime, but even if not, you'll still have the warm afterglow of this program to keep you toasty and full of hope. We've done 27 of these now. Couldn't have done them without the help of station manager Joey, engineer Paul, engineer Joe. Don't miss his program, Joe Salzone Live, Saturdays at 7:30. And Don Lewis, great to have him in the new time slot, 7 p.m. on Sundays. And everybody, just tune in at 7, listen to Don, and then keep it here from 8 to 9 for Dave's Gone By. Thanks to some other good people on WGBB, Bonnie D. Graham, host of Long Island's Dating, Fridays at 6, Vic Fusco. He has three different shows on the station, ranging from labor lines to country music, and the ubiquitous Mike Artsis, from the Sunday Big Mouth Brunch to Midnight Madness and more. And again, a reminder, Mike Artsis won't be on Midnight Madness tonight, but I will, along with engineer Paul and maybe some special guests, I'm not sure. It's at 11 o'clock tonight, 11 to midnight, so bring it back to GBB or just stay here for the rest of the evening. Thank you to my precious wife, Joyce. Thank all of you for tuning in and showing your support. All the emails, letters, phone calls, they really make a difference. So email me at davesgoneby@aol.com. No computer? Leave a message at 516-295-1511, 516-295-1511. Oh, and if you join the Bystanders Club or purchase cassettes of previous Dave's Gone By episodes, that supports the show even more. Details are on the website, hometown.aol.com /Dave's Gone By. Hometown.AOL.com. Don't forget that /Dave's Gone By. Next week, well, it's Passover time, and you know what that means. Our special guest, Rabbi Saul Solomon, will offer his rabbinical perspective on the holiday, plus the news gone by and more. So see us Sunday, 8 p.m. on WGBB and live on the net at WGBB.com. Until then, don't miss your days going by. This is Dave Lefkowitz. Good night. Bounce up and down on your spring and gone by.
And I will watch the ferry boats and they'll get high against the blue ocean, against the morrow sky.